Hi everyone, welcome to today's Current Affairs Daily Notes. Today's topic is National River Linking Project. I'm Ritrisha from GK Today and let us begin. So today we are going to discuss the following. What is the National Water Linking Project about? What is the history of this project? What is the current scope of the project? What are the benefits of such a project? How much will this cost India? What is some criticism or some drawbacks of this scheme? What are challenges that we are facing? And how can we move forward? To begin with, what is the National River Linking Project? The National River Linking Project, formerly known as the National Perspective Plan, envisages the transfer of water from water surplus basins where there is flooding to water deficit basins where there is drought or scarcity through inter-basin water transfer projects. What this means in simple terms is that if a river has surplus water left after meeting its own human, agricultural and industrial requirements, it can be transferred to another river which has deficit. So what is the history of this project? Interlinking of rivers was conceived more than 125 years ago by Sir Arthur Cotton, mainly to facilitate trade, but it was not implemented then. In India, K.L. Rao, an engineer and former irrigation minister, again revived the plan of linking the Brahmaputra and Ganga basins, which are the water surplus areas in the country, to the central and southern part of the country, which are the water deficit areas, to form a national water grid. So this happened in 1970. Now we move on to 1980. Ministry of Irrigation, which is now known as the Ministry of Water Resources, River Development and Ganga Rejuvenation, and Central Water Commission formulated the plan for national perspectives for water development. In 1982, the National Water Development Agency or NWDA was constituted to study basin-wide surpluses and deficits and look into feasibility of storing, linking and transferring water. It was during this time that the outline to divide the project in two components of Himalayan and Peninsula was planned, but the plan was again abandoned. Now, we move to 1999. The interlinking plan was revived again by the Commission for Integrated Water Resource Development. In 2002, the then President of India, Abdul Kalam, mentioned the river linking project during a speech. He proposed it as a solution to India's water woes, after which an application requesting an order from the Supreme Court on the matter was submitted. The application was converted into a writ petition, and finally, in October 2002, the Supreme Court ordered the central government to initiate work on interlinking the major rivers of the country. In the same year, a task force was appointed and a deadline of 2016 was set to complete the entire project that would link 37 rivers, but nothing concrete happened until almost a decade ago in 2012. The Supreme Court ordered the constitution of a special committee for interlinking of rivers headed by the Minister of Water Resources. The UPA government was not in favor of the interlinking project, but with the coming of the NDA government, river linking is once again in the limelight. Budget 2014-15 has earmarked rupees 100 crore to expedite the preparation of detailed project reports for this purpose. So what is the current scope of the project? The National River Interlinking Project will comprise of 30 links to connect 37 rivers across the nation through a network of nearly 3,000 storage dams to form a gigantic South Asian water grid, and it includes two components as you can see on your screen, the Himalayan component and the Peninsula component. Now, Himalayan rivers development component, under which 14 links have been identified. This component aims to construct storage reservoirs on the Ganga and Brahmaputra rivers as well as their tributaries in India and Nepal. The aim is to conserve monsoon flows for irrigation and hydropower generation along with flood control. The linkage will transfer surplus water from the Kosi, Gandak and Ghagra to the west. A link between the Ganga and the Yamuna is also proposed to transfer the surplus water to drought prone areas of Haryana, Rajasthan and Gujarat. Now the Peninsula Rivers Development Component or the Southern Water Grid includes 16 links that propose to connect the rivers of South India. It envisages linking the Mahanadi and the Godavari to feed the Krishna, Pennar, Kaveri and Vaigai rivers and this linkage will require several large dams and major canals to be constructed. Besides this, the Ken River will also be linked with Betwa, Parbati, Kali Sindh and Chambal rivers. Now, what are the main benefits of such a project? So, there are three main benefits. First is the hydropower generation. The river interlinking project claims to generate total power of 34,000 megawatt or 34 gigawatt. Out of this, 4,000 megawatt will come from the peninsular component, while 30,000 megawatt from the Himalayan component. It's hard to picture such a huge amount, but for example, the Tehri Dam. It is equivalent to 34 Tehri dams. It's that huge of a hydropower project. And a single Tehri dam, which has the capacity of 1,000 megawatts, was developed at the cost of total submergence of Tehri town and 40 villages. That's the amount of space you need for such a project. And partial submergence of 72 other villages, affecting lives of more than 100,000 people. So you can only imagine the kind of area this will need and the amount of livelihoods this will disrupt. But we can also count on this to provide drinking water. Now, this can be a probable end to our drinking water woes in India. The addition of hydropower is expected to curb the drinking water woes of millions and supply water to industries in drought-prone areas and water scarce cities in the South and the West India. There are also irrigation benefits. The project claims to provide additional irrigation to 35 million hectares in the water-scarce western and peninsular regions. This will further create employment, boost crop outputs and farm incomes and multiply benefits through backward and forward linkages. Along with this project, it is expected to create several benefits for navigation and fisheries. And of course, everything comes with a price. So how much will this cost India? The total cost of implementation is ₹560,000 crore, which is at a 2002 price level, with an annual outlay of ₹16,000 crores over 35 years. The cost consists of three components, which are ₹106,000 crore for the peninsula component, ₹185,000 crore for the Himalayan component, and ₹269,000 crore for the hydroelectric component. In terms of usage, the cost is estimated as ₹135,000 crore for the power component and ₹425,000 crore for the irrigation and water supply. Again, to put this colossal amount in some understandable proportion, we can contrast it to the single Tehri dam, which had cost about ₹8,000 crore. Now, there are of course criticisms to this, whether this is going to actually work and help the problems that we are trying to solve. So what is some of the criticism or drawbacks of this scheme? Firstly, interlinking of rivers is a very expensive proposal. The river interlinking project will also adversely affect land, forest, biodiversity, rivers and livelihood of millions of people. The Ken-Betwa link threatens about 200 square kilometers of the Panna Tiger Reserve. And as we all know, tigers are endangered. Interlinking of rivers will lead to destruction of the forest, wetlands and local water bodies, which are major groundwater recharge mechanisms. Also, less than positive experience that other countries have had, like diversion of Amu Darya and the Sir Darya, or the Australia's experiments in the Murray-Darling Basin. These have not been successful so far. It also causes massive displacement of people. Huge burden on the government to deal with the issue of rehabilitation of displaced people. And due to interlinking of rivers, there will be decrease in the amount of fresh water entering the seas. And this will, of course, cause a serious threat to the marine life. The Shah Committee pointed out that the linking of rivers will also affect natural supply of nutrients for agricultural lands through curtailing flooding of downstream areas. So what are the challenges that we are currently facing? India has 18% of the world's population, but we only have 4% of the usable water resources, which is a huge mismatch. Irrigation potential from interlinking rivers will have limited impact. The net national irrigated area from big dams has decreased, and India's irrigated area has gone up primarily due to groundwater. large hydropower projects are no longer a viable option in India. Storing large quantities of waters, most of the sites suitable for the big reservoirs are in Nepal, Bhutan, and the northeast. And people there are in opposition to big storage reservoirs. There are political challenges as well. Water transfer and water sharing are sensitive subjects. We recently observed that happening with Tamil Nadu and Karnataka about the Kaveri water sharing issue. Now, if the glaciers don't sustain the glacier mass due to climate change, the interlinking project will have limited benefit. Also, rivers tend to change their course and direction in about every 100 years. And if this happens after interlinking, then the project will not be feasible for a longer run, and so much money invested in this will be in vain. So what can we do instead? How do we move forward? Because there are obvious problems with drinking water and flooding and droughts in different sections of the country. So we can take a different route altogether instead of spending such a huge amount of money on interlinking rivers. The biggest, cheapest, most benign, and possibly the fastest and most decentralized storage option for India is the groundwater aquifer. Investing in water conservation and more efficient irrigation and better farm practices is also a solution. We need a mandatory enforceable river policy aimed at treating rivers as national treasure. Accumulation of silt in huge quantities, particularly in the Ganga and its tributaries, are a problem, and these rivers need to be desilted. Planting trees on the river bank is one way of bringing back the river to life. Forest catchments will need to be restored, wastewater from industries and towns will need to be treated, and sand mining need to be stopped. Need to build the responsibility, capability, and accountability in our water management institutions to revive our rivers. And the judicious use of canal water, growing crops that are appropriate to a region, and encouraging drip irrigation and reviving traditional systems such as tanks is a long-term solution. That's all for this video. If you want to read more about National River Linking Project, simply follow our link in the description below. And if you liked our efforts, please do like, share, and subscribe. Until next time, goodbye and good luck.